Bernhardine together. And Letty, how old would you? We want to think about what he has done to expand the kingdom of God in so many ways, and how it is that their faith has increased and was magnified in so many places with so many people over the years. You picked up an article that was written, and we don't know who wrote this. Somebody at Crossroads wrote this before Brendan and her meeting in 2005. I thought you would enjoy having a little bit of written history. And you also picked up the song that Bert wrote for the 10th anniversary of Crossroads and Mary Rookie with the music. So we'll sing these, we'll do this at the end. Patty will be us in those things. Or in that. So what we want to do is have people share some memories about Bert. And what I'm going to do is just send microphones around, like all just like this. So don't be taking pictures so that we can send it to Letty. But we're not going to just have, you know, if you don't want to do it right then, we'll come back to you. Okay, but I just want to keep sending the mics around so we don't have to be running around with microphones there. But I was going to say, I have, of course, many memories of Bert. Been here with him only 3 years, 77 to 80, but one of my favorite things is that he asked me to co-lead a quarter of Sunday school class on how to study the Bible. And I still have all my notes, you know, from that that we put together. As you do know, Bert was a wonderful lover of the Bible and a very good teacher and someone who could bring you to an important passage or something that would speak to where you were at that time. But that's one of my favorite memories. And I need to read one from Dave and Joy Forrest, who couldn't be here. When Joy and I traveled to Fort Lauderdale in 1965 to participate in the University of Beach Evangelism Project, we were welcomed by a smiling Southern gentleman named Bert Hardy. He and our writing staff prepared us to share the good news with college students on spring break. This was the beginning of a long friendship that continued through time on university staff and years later when we met again at Crossroads in 1981. He and Letty became some of our closest friends. We will always remember Bert's warm smile, words of encouragement, as well as his consistent example of Christian discipleship. His influence influenced our lives in many ways, and he will always be remembered as a dear friend and mentor. From David and Joy. I also have this picture, which I'll send around, which is a nice one of the two of them. You can see a little different than what you see there. So, David, why don't you talk, because you had some very early things about Bert, and I'll get another one.
You want us to stand?
Sure.
Good.
Thank you.
actually, that's why I came to this church, because I was doing, finished my schooling, I did my civic teaching, lived at home over in Lithonia, and knew about the church, so that's what brought me here. And I just really learned all the Sunday school classes and the way his eyes would light up when, you know, he saw somebody get a point he was trying to make, or, you know, going to different dinners at his house with the international students. But anyway, he was the only person I think that I let would always call me Mary.
Came to Atlanta to do some interviewing for a new production we were doing. plenty of time to get to the Harding Tone in Decatur. Only one problem, I went the wrong way on 285. So when I finally realized that, I knew I was going to be late, and I was getting really anxious and angry at myself. And finally got there probably half hour late, and they were, of course, were mighty gracious to me. But what I was interviewing them about was the time, and I hope I get the facts right on this, Bird had hired a new African-American staff from the Southeast, Ruth Lewis. And she was visiting in the Harding Tone at the time, but at the same time coming in for Bird's parents. And they refused to stay there. They refused to stay there if a black woman was staying there. And Bird had to say to his parents, well, then you'll have to stay somewhere else. And I'll never forget, that was kind of my introduction to the South, I think. That someone like Bert would even stand up to his own family for the convictions that were so important to him.
I think I made a strategic error because everyone's turning around to talk to everybody, but I made the camera be up here. And I wonder if I should make you move back there again. So you can make your face.
I'm Margaret Ozumanga. Paul and I were members here at the church beginning in 1988 until the mid-90s. But my first time to really have a Bert story were during my early years within the varsity. I was working in the Southeastern Regional Office here. And Bert and Letty were on our local committee, and my roommate Carolyn and I just were able to walk to their house. We lived really close to them. So they really parented us in some ways. And I was at their house one Sunday afternoon, and this was in the spring of 74. And I was about to spend a week being the caretaker for Walter Trobisch. And I was pretty nervous about it. I mean, I was just fresh out of college. Walter Trobisch was a well-known author and speaker on sexuality and family and emotional issues. And I had had some of his books as textbooks in my college class, and you know, I was just kind of gotta take care of this man. And I was talking to Bert about it, and in his Bert way, he said, "Now, Margaret, you know that man puts his pants on every morning, just like you and I do, one leg at a time. You are ready, just so I was, you know, it went well." And then later, many years later, when we were here at the church, I was able to work for Letty during her last 15 months as director of her preschool, and then to serve with Bert on the session and on the search committee with David and Ann and maybe some other folks here. But they've been friends through our whole lives and have been supporters of our work with the university, and we just love them here.
Jackie,
will check
here,
the Laura's going to say.
Yeah, Jackie.
Hello, folks. It's great to see
you.
Great to see so many Crossroads friends. A couple of quick things, memories of Bert. He gave a sermon one time. He didn't preach very often, but that one sermon I remember. The point he was making was we should be winsome people. And if anybody was ever winsome, that was Bert Harding.
Yes.
And the second thing is I always told myself, when I grow up, I want to be like Bert Harding. And of course, it hadn't worked out very well.
His love for people,
and I don't think he had a racist bone in his body. You know, we were studying with John, and I remember one night he said, you know, I don't know if my dad really knew the Lord, because he died hating white people. And you could feel the pain in his heart and in his words. But we just loved him. He was just a kind, sweet, gentle person. We just don't run into that kind of people all the time. And so it was a joy to be in Bible study with him for so, so many years.
Maul?
I was keep thinking about when I was in college, we were taking a class that were taught called Summary of Systematic Theology. Such a cool class. And it sounds pretty dry, and it was kind of intimidating, but I remember how much Bert loved that class. And I remember when he would be explaining a certain thing, he would get this little perky smile. I'd be so pleased with what he was telling us. And so that made it very interesting and exciting to take from him. I have another story that I think Terrence might tell with it or something.
Bill, would you like to say something?
Birth is I see different parts of my life that I was involved in birth. And when we first came to my home, when we visited the church, I didn't come in that old seats. And he came visit us and encouraged us to come back to visit the church. And we did. And I know I live in the choir. We've been in the choir for a long time. And then also with the young Bible study group. And same group for years and years. And then also then with the international, students national group, of which, of course, David hosted. And of course, he also hosted. And the largest group in that international group was the Brazilians. And it was great. I know Doug and Mary, they're also part of that group, many other people. But overall, I think it was a great and positive influence on my life. So I'm glad. And lastly, we were able to visit his home. We went to Jonathan's graduation from the Marines, and we invited to visit his home. So that's the last time I saw him there with his family. Again, yeah, terrific visit.
He officiated my wedding in my mother-in-law's living room. He prayed with me that I would have children, and I have two children. Bert was a prayer warrior. He understood the importance of opening our hearts to God. And he was just always accessible to me for some reason. Just a dear friend. I miss my friend.
Extra, extra, read all about it. That was Bert's favorite thing when he's making an announcement in the church. He'll sit back there and walk on, whatever, extra, extra, read all about it. Bert was the type of person who was very, very personable. And you can befriend him very easily. Bert came to my house when my daughter came. He and Betty came, and they brought a fresh, baked bread. You remember that? Brought it in a bag, and they brought it to us. And they were always reaching out to people. He loved to joke. One time he asked me to teach in the Bible study, and everybody knows that the book of Hebrews, there are scholars who believe that it was written by Paul, and there are those who believe that there is no known author. Well, I got confused that day, and I began to go, this is written by Paul, and this is, oh, some people disagree. And Bert said, man, I love you. So I get quiet. But the last time we saw Bert was 2 years ago. 2 years ago, and we went to Hilton Head. We went there for a vacation, and we decided to visit them. And we had a fun time with him. And then he came to me, Moses, I have lost my hearing. I said, oh, I'm sorry, but to hear that. So everything, he has a little lady, for lady to interpret it for him all the time. But we do miss him. He was a wonderful man.
Where's the other one?
I have a choir story, of course, about Bert. And we came here in 93, and at that time there was a contemporary service and then the traditional service. So we were part of the contemporary service for a while. And then when we went into one, it's when I joined the choir. So I sang in the choir, and my story about Bert is, you know, he was always kind of joking, but he was the leader of the bass section. I think Terrence, you're now having to step into the shoe. He was the leader of the bass section. He could read anything. He could do whatever. The bass section was never lost. And the thing, though, I remember about him the most is that his love and his knowledge of Scripture was impeccable. And if there was ever an anthem that we were singing that was not right with the Bible, he would have us change the words. And I always thought that was the best thing, that it had to be exactly the way that God would have wanted us to sing that song. And I just give him all the credit for making me start looking as a choir director what the words say about that. And so Terrence, that's also your second issue.
And I will never forget his passion right at the end in terms of his concern for us in the Vice Christian Fellowship, because he had been involved and he had been invested in our movement in terms of our commitment to the Bible, our commitment to Bible exposition, and it was a very powerful, very moving challenge that he gave us, which I still remember to this very day. Bert was a great friend, supported our work. I think Dave already mentioned that in terms of his career for us. And other people have said a lot of things. I appreciate the fact that later in life, he would take a whole year and go to Ethiopia and serve the Lord overseas on a mission field and come back and be a pioneer of Crossroads. And I value the moment that I was able to be with him a couple of years ago. I was at a conference in Brunswick, and I decided I need to stop by and see him. And because I wanted to communicate to him and Letty how much we appreciate his legacy and advice, and to update him on what was happening and our commitment to the Word of God. He was a giant, he was a legend. Yeah, a lot of people, there's a story within an ambassador that sometimes you don't put out in public, but there was a low point, I understand, just before my time, in 1964, when things were really difficult within the movement, and people like Bert and some other people decided that, look, the approach board said, look, we're going to do Havana 64, and if the board does not do something, what needs to be done, all of us are going to be out of here. And the board responded. And in a sense, he was one of those people who really challenged and kept us alive. That's one of the stories. Maybe a legend, maybe true or not, but I like the story because it sounds very much like him. And I really appreciate him and his legacy within the movement. And he was, of course, regional director in the Southeast. And so we celebrate him and we honor him and let him.
Terrence, do you want to speak now?
My name is Terrence Hayward. I remember Bert from when I first joined this church. And I was looking for somewhere to serve, and I decided to join the choir. And I had never been formally trained or anything, and I figured, this would be a snap, I can, serve. And then I found out I really couldn't sing. Emily Craig was the choir director at the time, and she put me to sit next to Bert. And she said, whatever he does, you do the same. And I had to apologize to him for a while, because the first time I heard the recording, I heard how bad I sounded. I had to go and say, Bert, I thank you. And every week when he said, are you coming next week? And I said, are you asking if I'm coming, or are you wondering if I'm going to come so you can prepare yourself? But it was a great time, and he was so humble. And unless you know the extent or depth to which he served, or his part in this congregation, I mean, he's so on the street. You see him and you don't understand, the body, what he meant at the time. But there's one thing that stood out. I remember we were getting ready to sing Ave Maria, and there were quite a few people, there were 30 people in the room. We were in the back, as usual. And when the choir director started the music, he just folded down and said, I'm not going to sing that. And he walked out of the room. And I'm sitting there thinking about who's going to help me now. But it set an impression on my mind, his conviction to the word and his faith. And once he made up his mind, you weren't going to change it. He knew what he knew, and that's it. And that has set a standard for me for the rest of my life. I never forget that. And you have a responsibility to be true to the word. And I live that to this day, starting with him. That's my memory.
Church in the late 1980s. We
we were like seeking Christians, but didn't let people know that. They thought we were good Christians. But you know, I thought Christians were all somber and serious and not fun until we went on a rafting trip with some Crossroaders. I don't know if anybody remembers that to the end of Caleb. Was anybody there? Well, anyway, Bert and Letty, thank you. And they got paired up with our friends who were also seeking Christians, and Alex and me. And while we were going down the river, we got stuck on this big rock. And these guys came along from some other group that had been drinking too much and started splashing water in our face. And my friend had on glasses and she couldn't see. And she let out a very bad word, calling him a very bad name. And also she looked at Bert and Letty, knowing they were Christians from here. And they just died laughing. And she's like, oh my goodness. But we remember that trip, the fun we had the rest of the trip. And I'm so glad that Bert and Letty both showed that grace Christians can have towards others and let things slip out of your mouth. I do wrong things, just reminding us of God's grace. And I just remember the joy, the laughter, the love, and the welcome that Bert Ladybug showed to everybody here. And they and others here drew us into a committed relationship with Christ, and our friends later too became committed Christians. So praise God for each of you.
Amen. I remember Bert and Betty, one of my first memories of them is the Solid Pepper dinners we used to have. They were the first couple that I actually went over to that home and had dinner with them. And I also remember when they were leaving, preparing to leave, I think we had a gathering for them, I'm pretty sure we did. And I had a conversation with Bridget, and they were talking about how much they were going to miss Crossroads. And the reason for missing Crossroads is that they had come to appreciate the diversity of the church, the way we sung different songs, and the makeup of the church had changed a lot. They said they were going to miss it. They were wondering whether or not they were going to have that at their next church or not. So they wanted to share that with those two on the news of Bert and Letty.
Anybody else want to do that? Does the pastor want to say anything? Oh, here we go. Bruce.
I'm Bruce Lewis. I came to Crossroads in the mid-late 90s. When I came here, I met the Hardings, Bert and Letty, and they were really good people. I really enjoyed getting to know them. One thing I really did appreciate about Bert, back in that time period, he was playing tennis. And I want to say he was, so he's 90 now, that was 20 years ago, so he was about 70 then. So I was very impressed that 70-year-old men were playing tennis and still leading a very active life. So I really appreciated that. Another memory I had of him was my family went on an extended vacation in the early 2000s and left me here in Atlanta. And Bert and Letty invited me over for dinner. So I went to their house and had a lovely dinner with them. And after that, Letty baked me several blackberry pies, blueberry pies, whatever she made. And they were absolutely delicious.
Anybody else? Anything else?
Hi, I'm Ben
Wilkinson.
Some of my favorite and most vivid memories of Bert, when I came to Crossroads and I was asked to be on a session, and Bert said, there's a couple of things I need you to do first. He said, first, I want you by next week to be able to recite the Apostles' Creed. And then, a week later, I need you to be able to recite the books of the Bible from Jim. And it's just too good. And I looked at him, I was like, what? And, you know, I came back and he said, you got the Apostles' Creed? So we went to, what was that, the library.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, let's hear it. So I went on and recited the Apostles. Good. Oh, so next week you're going to have all the books of the Bible for me, right? Next week? You got it? I said, I think so.
back in the library again, and I had to recite all the books. You got it, okay. You're in there. You're in there. And another memory, I there's two times I can remember that he and Letty were over to the house. I had a theater room when I used to live over here when I come in. Some of y'all remember
that.
He loved that theater. Oh, let's go in there and watch A Bug's Life. That's incredible. I had surround sound and the big screen and everything in there. That's incredible. This is incredible. And then you hear a sound coming from over there and another sound coming. That's incredible. I've never seen anything like this before. And the second time he came over, he brought a gift that he made. He made a wooden, we still have it, we still put our man a firefight. It's a wooden thing that you put your letters and stuff in, and envelopes and stuff, and it hangs on the wall. And he made it with his own hands out of wood and gave it to us as a gift. And we still, to this day, put our mail in that box.
And you're not going to tell the Ethiopian story that's so famous?
No.
Please!
That's a Letty story.
Oh, that's all right. Let's tell a Letty story. Can you tell it?
She's going to be watching it.
Yeah, she's going to be watching it.
Jack came back in the sanctuary
and got met. He said, oh, I know somebody that can probably talk to him. And he comes out with this little white lady. They started talking, and I was like, oh, that really stayed with me, because I wasn't about no church at all. I wasn't, had any no plans, but that scene really stuck with me. Now, I didn't come back to Crossroads a week later.
It was a year later.
But that experience is something that I'll never forget. And Letty communicated with the lady. We found out where she lived. They called the mosque, and found her mosque, and they took her in, and got her back to her family. But that's how I got introduced to Crossroads, from that experience.
I met you that night too. I remember talking with you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And let's see, who else? Anybody else want to say something? We have two mics. Does Pastor want to say anything? He doesn't have to. Okay. I'll take it back. Thank you all for sharing these many variety of things, and we see a breadth of dirt. I think that maybe we know a lot of it, but to hear everybody tell their own story, it's just wonderful to hear that, and I really appreciated what Denise said, that what's so good to us is that he is with the Lord right now. And I said, I wonder if Elmer can have another gate. there are so many people that want to meet him. Yeah, so we're thankful for that. And then just a minute, Patty can go up to the piano. I'm going to have a prayer. But then we're going to sing the song that he wrote for our 10th anniversary. And you'll see it is focused on the word quite a bit. We are there through and you'll see how that is. But let's pray. Father, we are so grateful that you send different people into our lives through different years. But we're so grateful for the recording. And you called him to be one of your children. You called him to be a child who was dedicated to prayer, who was focused on the word, and who knew that people needed to come to know you in a very personal way, and that he was such a teacher, and so many of the wonderful things that we've seen, how he cared for people in many, many ways. We're so thankful that he was in our midst, that he's someone that we knew, and that many of us have been able to see his example as something that we wanted to follow, that you used him as a discipler for us. We pray for Letty, for Mary Lou, Farley, and Becky, and Major and Bill and others in the family who are mourning him and who will have a service later in June to remember him and to, in a way, send him on his way where he's already there, but to have that sense of being together. So we pray for them as they prepare for that. And as you are with them in the grief that they have, but in the joy that they also have, knowing that Bert has left this home where he's an alien to come home to be with his Father in heaven. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay.
I'll see
you. Oh, yeah. Let's stand and sing this. Really concentrate on Bert's words. It's a wonderful hymn for the 10th anniversary of this church.
Oh,
Thank you, and amen. And feel free to check with one another for a moment.
Amen.